Sim First Nation has a responsibility to respect and protect the lands and resources of our territory for further generations. We actively seek to align ourselves with others who have the same vision. We wish to manage our natural resources sustainably and engage in projects that have us that have as small as an environmental footprint as possible. In the matter of aligning ourselves with like-minded people and organizations, we are pleased to work alongside others in making geothermal energy in our territory a reality. This geothermal energy initiative fits many of the criteria we believe to be important in the development of natural resources in an environmentally appropriate manner. It's a renewable resource that is available for an indefinite period. It can be developed and operated at a reasonable cost. It leaves a small environmental footprint. There are few emissions. It has great potential for a variety of applications such as electricity, greenhouses, and aquaculture, to name a few. It can also assist with food security for our region. As the initiative continues, the Sim First Nations look forward to contributing our human and financial resources as our capacity permits to the successful development of functioning geothermal plant in the region. The new federal government has committed itself to supporting environmentally friendly resource development. We are willing to add our political voice to the support of this project. Our grandchildren will thank us for efforts to support this environmentally responsible initiative. Cook's Jam, thank you from Nathan, Matthew, and myself, Jules Phillip.
I'm Craig Dunn. I'm a chief geologist with a very small company called Borealis Geopower. I think for the running joke that some of you might have heard is I'm a recovering oil and gas geologist. I've been working in exploration geoscience for most of, if not all of my geology degree, and I drank the geothermal Kool-Aid about 8 years ago. I've been involved with Borealis for seven. And one of the opportunities that we've had from the origin of our company was to develop the property here at Canoe Reach. It's been a very long go of this, but our goal as a company, and for me personally, is to help build Canada's first geothermal power plant. Yeah, don't clap until we did it, but okay. We're trying. That's a start. I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience, and I think a few of you might have bored with this geothermal 101 in the past. When we're watching this, I want to make advocates for the industry. I don't just want people to understand what we're doing. I need every little bit of support, whether it's talking to your neighbor or your politician or your local finance guy, that this is an incredible opportunity. We see so many of the benefits, but what I really want is when you're listening, try and think about how would I tell someone else about this story. So even if you've heard this before, it's one thing to learn it, it's another thing to teach it. And we don't need just people understanding it, we need people advocating for us. So just, if you're bored, just try and think of it that way. This was probably one of the big things as a matter. This is one of the big things when I got into energy is you need to take a really holistic approach to energy. Try and understand all the different aspects. You know, what does it cost to build it? How much does it cost to run? We use a term called levelized energy costs. So when we incorporate a power facility or your car, when I bought it, how much does it cost to run? How long am I going to run it for? What is the best bang for your buck? And that's environmental aspects, that's community engagement, that's the whole picture. So looking at energy as a whole, that's going to drive me crazy. Am I the only one you can hear?
No.
Bad.
I'll just go over there. We'll try this again. I wanted everyone to start to think about all the different aspects of energy development. So what does it cost to build? How do you incorporate all these things? And so I made a list for myself before a presentation. I thought, what is the best possible energy? Maybe I'm working in the wrong industry. So I went, what's a reliable source of power and heat? So people don't, you know, sometimes we think, hey, what turns the lights on? But in many cases, we also need to know what warms our building. Then we have to start thinking of, okay, what is a steady source of revenue? You know, what may make sense in 18 months might not make sense in 2 or 5 years. Can you predict the price of your fuel cost in 5, 10, 15, 20 years out? Has anyone taken a natural gas bet on 20 years? No? How about oil in 6 weeks? Right? So this is the type of thing that we need to think about as a whole is, if I'm going to build this today, do I know the price of power 10 years from now? Do I know the price of power in 30 years from now? And so when we build large-scale projects, we need to develop those ideas as we're developing it. So, you know, a long-term revenue with a known fuel cost. Does anyone know what I mean by known fuel cost? The input you put into your plant, so whether it's natural gas, uranium, you need to know what that's going to cost today and then what it's going to cost in the future. So one of the things that I always think about is, if you can know that value and you can put price on it in 20 years, then you'll have an idea of what your whole project's going to cost over the life scale of the project. Small environmental footprint, you know, 30, 40 years ago, this may not have been that big an issue. You built what was, you know, we thought was the best development. We're now seeing more and more people interested in what is the impact of that energy resource, and that's environmental footprint. From a finance perspective, you never want to be first. I'm going to try and be first. And it's a lot harder from a financing perspective because people see first as risk. So you need to make sure that you're a mature industry globally. People can say, hey, I've seen that built somewhere else in the world. I get what you're trying to do. Then we talk about actual, is it inexpensive? Are you actually in a position where this power supply over the course of its life is one of the cheapest, right? Baseload. How many people know what the term baseload means from an electrical perspective? Okay, that's painful. What we're looking at is, when I turn the lights on, do they go on? So in a power distribution environment, I need to make sure that my generation is constant, that I'm always available to deliver power when it's needed. So what we do in many cases with intermittent power supplies, we have something back it up. So if something goes on, something else goes off. If nothing is on, your lights don't go on. So Super Bowl Sunday, you know, 2:30, Grey Cup Sunday, people expect in Canada that when you turn your lights on, they go on. I think the community of Valemount might have a little bit different view on this once in a while than someone in downtown Vancouver. Is that a fair assessment? Is that a nice way to put it? And then the last part is...
8 hours a year.
8 hours a year. That's it. It's enough to be unstable. And that's, I think, people from... we had a good friend of mine who worked in India for a number of years. They had power from 2 to 5. 2 to 5 p.m. So when you think about how much you appreciate, you know, electron into your lights, I think it's a really, we get a bit spoiled here in Canada because we assume we turn the lights on, they're going to go on. And so what happens behind the scenes in many cases is not something people think about. The last part of this project is, I'm going to try and build a geothermal power plant in the Kinbasket area, in the Robson Valley. I need to know that the people who live here day in, day out, First Nations, community, all of that, that they actually support this project. The last thing I want to do is try and develop something, and I've worked on the other side of industry, where you're pushing and it's not the community pulling you forward. And so that's a huge, huge aspect. And more and more projects you work on, the more you realize if you don't have community support, and you don't have the First Nations support, and you don't have everyone excited about your project, it's probably going nowhere. I think there's probably a few pipeline companies that, you know, may agree with me now. So we're going to do the geothermal 101, because when I went through this list, I realized, okay, even if it's hard to go first, it's worth it, because this geothermal opportunity fit so many of those criteria. So now I'm going to tell you why, so that you don't just think I'm a geothermal fanatic. How does geothermal work? This is a simple hydrothermal geothermal program. Our planet producing a ridiculous amount of heat. Anyone know how long our planet's been cooling? Come on, I have one geology class.
Okay.
6,000 years? What?
It's
4.6 billion years. Yeah, 4.54, yeah, depending on who you talk to. But yeah, about 4.6 billion years. Does anyone know how long that we're gonna be able to generate heat from our slowly decaying planet? 6 billion, with a B, quite a bit longer. So when we talk about a renewable energy resource, it's not entirely true. There's only about 6 billion years worth of heat left. It'll be okay, it's okay. What we're actually seeing is that in many cases, the geothermal opportunity occurs when it's closest to surface. So we have this ridiculous amount of heat, but that energy doesn't do us any good if it's trapped in our planet. So in the cases for geothermal, what we're actually looking for is the places where hot water is coming to surface. That is acting as the heat transfer. So bringing that heat to surface makes geothermal economic. If I have to drill to 10 kilometers, I don't have a project. In places like Northern California, where I may drill 8 kilometers or even less than, and it's 200 degrees C, that is some of the first places that we've developed our geothermal resource. In places like Iceland, they can drill a few hundred meters and be able to produce steam from that resource. That actually produces some of the cheapest power on our planet, period. We're going to see some of those numbers. What we actually want to see is a recharge. So actually cold meteoric waters moving into that deep fractured system, and those fracture systems allowing that steam to come to surface. This is a constantly recycling system, and if managed correctly, can run indefinitely.
Planet Earth. It's hot and full of energy. If you've ever observed an erupting volcano, sat in a geothermal hot spring, or visited the geysers at Yellowstone National Park, you've experienced geothermal energy. The deeper you travel into the Earth, the hotter it gets. The Earth's crust is made of rocks and water. Underneath the Earth's crust is a layer of hot molten rock called magma, which is even hotter than the Sun's surface. This Earth heat, also called geothermal energy, is a clean, renewable source of both power and heat. The energy from less than 10 kilometers deep contains 50,000 times more energy than all the oil and natural gas resources in the world. Globally, geothermal currently generates enough electricity to meet the needs of 60 million people. We can harness this vast energy by developing geothermal power projects, or Geopower. Using today's technology, we can locate and drill into the geothermal resource at only a few kilometers deep and capture the rising hot water and steam. Releasing a small amount of that heat in the right way can create electricity, and the formation water is reinjected back into the same reservoir underground to be reheated and recycled. Binary turbine power plants use hot formation water to vaporize another fluid. The second fluid drives a turbine and generator to produce electricity. This closed-loop system produces no emissions and has one of the smallest environmental footprints of any power supply. Geothermal plants provide power 365 days per year, 24 hours per day, and projects are designed to operate a minimum of 20 to 30 years. Its clean electricity is delivered via power lines to your community. Borealis Geopower has a project goal to develop a 15 to 20 megawatt energy power facility. This is enough to provide clean, renewable electricity for over 15,000 homes. The advantages of geothermal do not stop at clean power. The Geopower facility's waste heat can be used for a variety of community applications, including district heating for greenhouses, hot spring bathing, fish farms, and timber drying, to name just a few. By harnessing our Earth's heat resource, we can create a clean, renewable energy project that can grow your community today and create an ideal model for energy development for the next generation of Canadians.
Questions? It's like 2 minutes of as clear as I could possibly make geothermal.
Why is it limited to 30 years?
Because by that point the power plant will have to be usually rebuilt or reassessed, or you take brand new technology that wasn't available 30 years ago and make a power plant even more efficient. So in many cases we're seeing places like Northern California where they've been running this in the same reservoir since like the 1950s. So the reservoir itself won't wear out, it's your surface facilities that do. So you guys saw this map. I think one of the things that we've seen more and more is globally, where are the opportunities? Anyone's taken a simple geology class post-1970s, we have this thing called plate tectonics, and that's allowing us to be able to see that, you know, there's parts of our planet that are slowly running into each other or separating, and this plate tectonic environment creates some of those areas of thinness within our global environment, allowing these heat resources to come to surface. There's a few anomalous, interesting ones like Iceland, which is on a divergent plate boundary. We're seeing places like Hawaii, basically like a hole, I think is probably the nicest way of describing it, within some of these tectonic environments. But in reality, this entire strip that we see down the western side of North America and South America is creating some phenomenal opportunities, many of them in the process of being developed, like Northern California. The US itself is actually 3,400 megawatts, I think is the recent number. They're leading the world in terms of global production for geothermal energy. But Mexico's number four, and there's a number of projects moving forward throughout the Caribbean and South America. So we're seeing global development in this field. Some of the places where it's growing the fastest is actually in Turkey and East Africa. In many cases, they may jump over the fossil fuel opportunity altogether. So if they can develop their geothermal resource in places like the East African Rift, they're moving directly into renewable energy development. I got a job offer to Djibouti, which I had to look up. The Canadian energy potential, you saw that map, we're on there, and yet we're at 0 megawatts. What we get a lot is, well, there's no geo, if there's 0 megawatts, there must be no opportunity. And I just, right out of the gate, I want to say that's completely not accurate. The Geologic Survey of Canada report back from 2011 is actually one of the most downloaded reports in the GSC library. I don't know if that means anything to anybody, so it probably had 7 versus all the other ones that had 5. But this report, all 200 and something pages of it, actually outlined that this resource opportunity is massive, and it's not just for power, it's all the different opportunities for mining and oil and gas and direct heat and so on and so forth. So if you have an inkling, you can go read all 236 pages. What we're actually seeing in many cases in terms of resource opportunities, we've actually seen these resources already. We've already studied them. There's work back from the 1970s. Places like Canoe Reach, you know, this is a known hot spring area. Water coming out of the ground at 50 to 70 degrees Celsius. This is anomalous, to say the least. But we have places like Meager Creek near Pemberton, where we actually have temperatures recorded, downhole temperatures, above 200 degrees Celsius. This is world-class geothermal opportunity. Anywhere else in the world, they'd be like, that's a great, you should start there. And we'll talk a little bit about, you know, why we haven't developed this resource yet. But when we start to look, and for me, it was a real eye-opener. The more places I looked, the more I realized nobody had looked before, or there wasn't enough people looking for a project development. Places like Yukon, where there's a number of opportunities in the hot springs, a number of very, very clear indications of geothermal potential. The last part of this, if anyone's coming from an oil and gas background, anyone? Couldn't afford to drive here? too soon? The oil and gas application for me, as an oil and gas guy, I've been on wells where they actually are drilling down to 4 or 5 kilometers, 4.8 kilometers. We are seeing temperatures, and this is, they're not that geothermally interesting, but we're actually touching reservoirs that are 150 to 170 degrees Celsius. Do you know what we do with that wastewater? Anyone, come on. We inject it back. Do we strip the energy resource out of it before we do it? Very, 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 very rarely. So we actually are, the joke I make is we're drilling for gold. If we don't find it, we throw out the silver. Now, the geothermal energy resource, although we have a massive amount of it, it's the density that causes a problem. Is these are lower energy density. So the amount of energy in a liter of water is nowhere near the amount of energy in a liter of oil. The difference is this is a renewable opportunity that can constantly sustain itself. So that's one of the things that has sort of held us back. This comment is nicely thrown in by Allison here, the here and now. We get this joke a lot, is that, yeah, this geothermal thing, I love it. It's gonna be great in 10 years. We've been saying that since the 70s. There's been multiple people through this time frame that have looked at this opportunity and gone, oh, we can get there. We just need this or just need that. What we're finding now is a lot of the pieces are coming into place just nicely. So hopefully it's no longer a future thing, it's a now thing. This is a big issue that we see. The word geothermal is this sort of catch-all phrase. It's sort of like saying, you know, fossil fuels. There's all sorts of different opportunities within the geothermal world. And the one that most people think of is the geoexchange. The heat pump idea. So what we're using is electricity to move and concentrate heat. And you know, infrastructure-wise, if you have a clean energy resource for electricity, this actually becomes a really clean way of making heat.
It does have some of the same issues that we do in terms of an initial capital cost, but the larger the projects, usually, the more cost opportunity there is for geoexchange. We're moving to the other end of that spectrum. The far end of that spectrum is things like dry steam, where in Iceland they basically hook up a flywheel over top of a geyser and boom, you have power. 2 cent power. Yay! That opportunity is, to some extent geologically, we're going to find those places first because we literally have steam coming out of the ground. So if I could drill Yellowstone, I would. Because that is one of the best sort of global opportunities that people look at and go, how do I understand what geothermal is? A geyser or a volcano. Right? We see that in the original video. Moving between those two, we see slightly lower temperatures, like 150 to 170 degrees C. We're starting to get into temperatures where we use in the binary cycle, like you saw in the video. It's a secondary fluid that is flashing steam, and that allows us to actually have zero emissions on a lot of these facilities. Because the water that we're using, the only thing we're taking out of that water is the heat. And we're trying to re-inject it back in because we want that water to be able to continue to deliver heat to surface. So the binary cycle allows us to produce power out of lower end steam. I heard a rumor about a guy who actually made power out of 74 degrees C. Is it true?
Excuse me.
Caught asleep there.
Well, I don't think I was asleep.
The other side of it is, what happens when you're just below the capability of the binary cycle? What happens to that water that's, you know, 90, 80 C down to 40 C? Do we throw that out as well? Or do we start to use other applications for it, like greenhouses and aquaculture and all of these other things that we would normally assume would need a natural gas, propane, or maybe a wood pellet kind of environment to create? If we're basically throwing away heat resource, we have to start thinking about what can we do with it. And you guys will get about another 4 hours of this, so I'm not going to focus too long on that side of it. But I think at the end of the day, we need to think of the whole spectrum of geothermal opportunity and what can that do for your community. So making power, we have a couple slides on this, and then you have, as I say, about 4 hours of geothermal direct heat. But what people have a lot of sort of feedback loop about is that, well, how are you turning heat into power? How do you actually make that jump? And you're going to use a lot of water, Craig. I'm like, we don't use the water. We use it like a backpack. It's transferring that heat because it's the gigajoules of heat energy that's giving me the opportunity to actually move that into a power environment. So what happens is the heated water goes through the turbine, produces electricity, and I'm re-injecting. It's constant re-injection, which means that I need permeability in my rock. So if I'm given a giant granite table and there's no crack in it, there's no way to move that water through that system. So even if there's heat trapped in the center of that granite rock, I can't get it out. It's stuck. And spending money pumping and cracking, this is not a good solution. So what I want to find is places where the rock is beautifully fractured and that water can move in and out. I think we're sitting on one. So we're actually sitting on the Rocky Mountain Trench. You know, mountain ranges on every side. This is a place where our planet is literally fracturing rock all the time. And the deep, deep fluid movement is because we have a fractured rock environment. Okay. I've already made an off-color joke about the oil patch, but I'm going to give them a whole whack of credit here, and the mining industry for that matter. We are, as a country, some of the best subsurface geoscientists on the planet. We actually are better at drilling than most on the planet. We're faster, we're more efficient. In many cases, we're more environmentally friendly when we do this. When we ship companies globally to develop oil, gas, gold, all of it, chances are there's a Canadian geoscientist or engineer on that team. People don't realize how much knowledge we have gained by developing, in many cases, what are now marginal resources. The rest of the world may have an opportunity, but what we've managed to do in Western Canada and Canada as a whole is get very, very good at things like drilling, resource exploration, exploration analysis. This process means that we've not only gotten faster, but just plain better. And so what I would love to see is take all of that knowledge base and apply it to geothermal because there's so much overlap. I didn't start it out as a geothermal geologist. I started out as an oil and gas guy. Right? So when I see what we're capable of and how much of that information isn't getting technology transferred into the geothermal sector, I feel like we've missed an opportunity. This one chart up top actually shows that since 1997, we went from drilling 3 kilometer wells, literally 3 kilometers down, or in this case, two kilometers sideways, and I've been on these projects. We went from drilling them in about a month, a little over 6 weeks to some extent earlier in this program, to now we can drill wells like that in less than a week. How many people knew we got that much better? This is the worst part. So that means that my drilling cost goes from taking a month at $20,000 a day, you know, for the drill rig itself, down to maybe half of that just on the time frame alone. The other aspect of this is that we are currently sitting on approximately 79% of the rigs that would normally be working 2 years ago are not working. They're sitting and waiting for work. What could we be doing with that opportunity? At the end of the day, I would love to see Canadian geoscientists all over the world developing new bit technology, casing design, exploration strategy for geothermal, because it's a wasted opportunity if we don't. So how does drilling work? How many people have ever sat on a drill rig? Hey, that's pretty good, actually. Here we go. So the rest of you are going to get educated about how we punch holes in the ground.
The first step is to install the drilling rig. Drill pipes are a series of pipes screwed into each other, at the end of which a drilling tool called a drill bit is attached. The drill bit attacks the rock by putting pressure on it and rotating. It breaks up the rock and grinds it into small pieces as it slowly digs into the ground. To prevent the hole from getting clogged up by sediments as drilling progresses, rock cuttings need to be removed and the bottom of the well cleaned. A fluid called drilling mud is used for this. The mud is injected through the drill string, then rises up between the well bore and the drill string, carrying the cuttings back to surface. A closed circuit makes it possible to recycle most of the mud used and send it back into the hole as drilling progresses. Once at the surface, a pipe takes the mud to a shale shaker, which separates the cuttings from the mud. Then the mud is sent to a settling basin in a continuous cycle. Drilling fluid is also used to stabilize the borehole and prevent it from collapsing. It is also used as a way to lubricate and cool down the drill bit. Cutting samples are then taken from the shale shaker and washed in water before being analyzed by a geologist. To prevent the hole from collapsing, a steel casing is installed through the full length of the well. Joints of casing are screwed onto each other as they are inserted into the hole. Once this stage is completed, the casing serves as a pump chamber for the extraction well and an injection conduit for the injection well. The three main stages of drilling, casing, and cementing are respectively repeated as many times as necessary to reach the target aquifer. The more casing stages there are, the smaller the drill hole diameter is, as the casing takes up an increasing amount of room, thereby reducing the initial diameter of the well hole. Therefore, a well with a diameter of 50 centimeters could be reduced to 20 centimeters after several casings have been installed. Cementing the casing in the well is a key operation to ensure that groundwater quality and well integrity are maintained. It involves pouring cement into the space between the casing and the well bore. Cementing is intended to seal the casing against the levels crossed, thereby protecting the quality of the groundwater collected. This means that it prevents water from different levels from mixing, as well as the infiltration of surface water. Great care must be taken when performing this bottom-upward cementing operation. Pressure, flow, density, and the volume of the cement injected must be rigorously controlled. Once the cementing has been injected, it requires up to 48 hours to set. The sand screen is a key piece of equipment in a water collection structure. It is a perforated tube placed in the aquifer. It is used to extract or inject water, allowing water to pass while preventing fine particles, such as sand, from passing into the tube. It must be resistant to corrosion and pressure and have a long service life. The type of sand screen used is determined according to the form and void percentage to combine water output and speed in openings. Once the sand screen is sunk, the water raises up to a certain level. An electric pump then needs to be submerged to pump the water up to the surface. But before this, excess mud remaining in the hole needs to be purged by airlift. This involves injecting compressed air into the well to push up the water and the mud, which will then spring out of the well. In addition to removing mud, it also tests the productivity of the geothermal reservoir. It is a form of trial. Once performed and successful, the well can be used. The submerged electric pump allows the well to be operated and provides heating for housing through a heat exchanger. In conclusion, an extraction well brings hot water to the surface using a submerged electric pump. The water is sent through a heat exchanger to recover the calories. If the temperature of the underground water is high enough, it can be used directly. Otherwise, the heat can be increased using a heat pump, if need be. The water is then returned to the aquifer via the injection well. Geothermal energy is a continuous and local renewable energy source. It improves our environmental footprint by reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Geothermal energy has a number of uses, including providing individual and industrial heating and generating electricity.
Riveting? I joke that the ugliest part of our geothermal project is usually drillers. They don't think that joke's nearly as funny. One of the first things we pointed out in the slideshow was that you need a mature industry. You want to see that this has been done somewhere else first. You're on the leading edge. You don't want to be on the bleeding edge of this system. So what we do in a lot of cases, we reference a lot of sort of analogous projects globally. We say, hey, this has been done in, well, Oregon, like that's so far away. But we also want to say, you know, this formation looks like this one in New Zealand or this one in Italy. That way we can say, well, what equipment worked on that site? How long has that one been running? What did they run into? What are their problems? So when we talk about a worldwide source of power, it's really helpful for us in Canada to look and say, what worked? Because I don't need to reinvent the wheel here. I don't need to be first at the turbine and drilling and everything else. I can use all of those examples from global successful projects. You know, places like New Zealand that have been powered, a huge chunk of their power production comes from geothermal, and they're global advocates to the point where some of their consulting companies work internationally, teaching everyone what they've learned in the New Zealand experience. Iceland, a community of 300,000, 320, they export geothermal consultants everywhere. And they actually have multiple companies that actually just do that in places like Africa, Japan, New Zealand. It's actually pretty amazing. And if we can take that level of knowledge that we have and then apply it globally, we could be doing the same. You guys have seen this map. This just goes to show how many global power plants. This is actually even outdated. I think there's been two since.
One last week.
Just happened?
Ormet turned on, a really large plant.
Ah, very cool. Learn something new. We joke geologically these don't stop at the border. That question mark is actually over multiple active volcanoes in Canada, believe it or not. And so what we love to be able to show is that this power plant from this location can be used in this example, or this is how hot this water is, this is the corrosion issues they may have suffered, so that we can use those global answers to some of the problems we might have at our facility. Even, you know, there's actually more going in Chile. There's a whole whack that are being developed right through the Caribbean as well. There's one in Nevis that's going forward, just got news. And then this whole section through Turkey down through the East African Rift, as Allison pointed out, is actively moving forward. So we don't have to, you know, feel any shame that we're still not on the map, because there's enough people moving this in the right direction globally that the geothermal industry's healthy, to say the least. We've talked about this in terms of the power supply. The video is probably a bit helpful. There's one aspect of this that is actually a bit skewy, and as a geologist, I had to get my head around the engineering, is that the temperature of the water is massive, but we're thinking about a liter of water carrying X number of joules at a certain temperature. So if you think in gigajoules, I actually think in gigajoules, it's energy per liter. And if I have a higher temperature, then I have more energy. But if I can flow that water faster, then I'm moving more energy through that system. That's part of the equation. But the other half of this is that I actually want a change in temperature. So if I go from 0 to 50, does that look like 50 to 100? Or if it's 100, what if I can get my ambient air or ambient water down to 100? That 100 degree temperature gradient gives us more energy than just going from 50 or 100 down to 50. Now, it's a little confusing until you get outside in a Canadian cold air environment and you realize that I might have the same water temperature as the guy in Arizona, but he can't get his water down below 30 when I might be able to get it down to zero. And the reason we see some of these successful facilities that are running at, you know, 74 degrees Celsius is because they have an offset, like glacial-based waters, which are currently flowing down the side of multiple mountains in the area. So for us, that cold air climate is actually a huge benefit to the success of the turbine itself. They don't have to be ugly facilities. That's another big one. This one is in Iceland, the bottom one. The other one's in, this is Mammoth, right, in California? I think it's California. So basically what you're seeing on the surface outside is basically the same kind of thing that's going on inside this Icelandic facility. They actually use these for like art gallery events type stuff. These colors all change and they can make it into this cute little art light show. This is a binary geothermal facility that they basically designed to be part of the landscape. So when you see photos of it during the day, you know, it's built the way that the community said, hey, let's make this at least a scenic site. The Blue Lagoon is another great example of, you know, incorporating a design of a power facility into part of the ecosystem, into the ecotourism destination. You can make these things look the way you want because there is no emissions associated with the binary facility. So why am I still excited? How did I do on my ideal energy list? Is it renewable? Yes. 6 billion years, you got to give that to me. We'll call that even. Is it a mature industry? You've seen how many other places globally. The long-term revenue, we haven't talked about too much. When we design these, we want to produce base load renewable power for as long as I can get that contract. So when I'm thinking, you know, I don't want to sign a 10-year contract, I want to sign 20 and 30-year contracts so that I know that I can produce that power over and over and keep getting that electrical paycheck. That's part of the equation. The other side of it is long-term revenues with no fuel cost. So once that capital's in the ground, it doesn't cost me any more money to get the heat out of the ground besides the pump. So I actually don't have that risk associated as I go forward. The preferred choice for energy for many utilities, this is actually really interesting because I'm providing a baseload power, is that my utility doesn't have to then offset me with something else. They can say, hey, you're contractually obligated to deliver power 98% of the time or 95% of the time. That's literally in my contract to sell the power. That creates an opportunity for them to go, good, I don't need anything else. Because if you don't show up, then you know, you take the hit. That allows a number of opportunities for your infrastructure to be a little bit more stable. As I say, Super Bowl Sunday, you turn the lights on, you want those lights to go on. TV better show up on Grey Cup, right? This last one, how many people would guess this? One of the lowest levelized costs of power. Geothermal the cheapest? Yeah, right. You got all this other good stuff going on. What are the odds? The US DOE actually has a slide that we have in there somewhere. I thought it was next. That actually shows that geothermal over the lifespan of the projects turns out to be some of the cheapest energy we produce on our planet. Places like Iceland beautifully skew the data with, you know, 1 and 2 cent power grid. We ship aluminum, bauxite technically, all the way to Iceland to be produced, and then we ship it globally. That is, why would we do that? Why would you send that much rock to the middle of the Atlantic and then back out, you know, globally around the world? It's because it is so energy intensive to produce this that you're going to go wherever the cheapest power supply you can get. And for Iceland, it's hydro and geothermal. These are not small projects to develop. This is probably one of the hardest parts of the technically complex projects. You have to deal with power, you have to deal with the geologic environment, you have to deal with long-term infrastructure design. One of the things that makes this interesting is that these things can take anywhere from 4 to 7, in some cases, 20 or 30 years to develop. In most cases, start to finish, you could probably get through the whole project without any problems in about 3 to 5 years. But what we see is any kind of delay, if you have any problems with funding, exploration, you're going to drag these project scales out. This is not for the faint of heart in terms of the investment, because I'm not going to be able to open it, flip it, and send it somewhere else. So what we're looking at is partners, in many cases, project developers that have that longer term vision. So if you imagine, if I started today from scratch, I'm going to be probably 6 to 7 years before I'm power development. And that's sort of the best case scenario. In many cases, a lot of this first part of the structure here, when we're looking at phase one, hopefully you can read this, you identify the site, you do the exploration drilling. Many, many projects never survive phase one. You'll start to look into it and you'll go, oh, there's no room on the power line, or the geologic environment isn't what I thought it was, or there's no road access, so on and so forth. So once you've survived that sort of site identification, then you have to say, do I have a resource that's worth drilling? Still considered fairly risk, as you can see from here, but as you start to drill out your reservoir, you can verify that you have the heat resource you need to continue working. At that point, you start to move into power purchase agreements and contracting, and then you're actually looking at the construction of the surface facilities. Everybody loves this stage, because now you have a revenue stream associated with your energy resource. So if I'm a finance guy, I'm looking at that and going, hey, how much is your project worth? It's worth what the power and the heat you sell from that project. So this is actually an interesting way to look at it is that as I'm reducing risk, I'm also having to spend more and more money moving from drilling into power facilities. This is a ballpark breakdown of a number of projects we've looked at globally. At the end of the day, the hardest part just to go through with this process is the exploration and drilling. And then most of this looks pretty similar to other project development strategies, you know, in terms of natural gas or even nuclear for that matter, is that your power plant is probably almost 40 to 50% of your overall project cost. At this point, you've already proved out your exploration program and your drilling. You know how many megawatts you have. It's just a matter of building the facility to turn them into power. So at this point, when you're building your power plant as probably the last part of your project development, you're in a great position to say, I know what I have the revenue stream, and your debt finance now comes into play. The top half of this circle is normally venture capital and you know, sort of friends and family type of exploration funding. On the left, at the end of the day, it's not about, you know, hot fractured rocks. It's about how many megawatts mean how much can I sell it for, and how do I finance my project. So what we're looking at is a gigajoule of energy is worth how much money. At the end of the day, how much can I sell that for, whether it's power or heat? Pretty straightforward. Do you guys have any questions about this? Everyone's very quiet.
Riveted.
Yeah, let's hope so. This goes back to the cost analysis, is we actually see that when we level the playing field, we incorporate the whole project cost, start, finish, development, overall operations, environmental assessments, all of it, all of your costs incorporated. Geothermal's coming in pretty close to the old legacy coal guy, pretty close to the hydro. Now, geothermal and hydro have one key advantage in here, is there's no fuel cost. The heat out of the ground does not cost me money to produce. Right? It's there. It's already there, as long as I can tap it. The same with the hydros. Once that massive facility is built, the river doesn't charge you per liter. And I think that that's a huge aspect of this, is that those ones are hurt by the very fact that you put in all of the capital at the front, and then it continues to pay out over time. And because it's a renewable resource, it just continues to pay out over time. So what we see is these stats in general show that your overall cost scenario is actually quite good. You just have to be a little patient. This is my favorite slide. This is one of those sketchy organizations that puts out data just for geothermal. It's called the DOE, Department of Energy in the US. Yeah, that's tough crowd. This is looking at the same idea of levelized cost. Now, one of the things that's interesting about this chart, not only does it show that we're, you know, 25 to 50 in that, you know, dollars per megawatt hour, but it actually has a neat idea that took me a while to get my head around, a levelized avoided cost of energy. So what this is telling us is if I can develop something else, should I? So if I am, let's say, advanced combined cycle, okay, so natural gas type facilities, chances are if I have that opportunity, I should probably take that opportunity. There's not much a lot better than that. So then you go, okay, well, let's look at it as a comparison. Let's say I have a wind resource. They're saying, well, there's chances are you're going to probably want to look at something besides just the wind resource. No, this is the DOE. This isn't just Craig. If I have a biomass opportunity, there's probably something else that's cheaper, i.e. advanced combined cycle. So if I have a wind facility, they're saying all things being equal, maybe I should be looking at another resource energy, right? Another opportunity. And the New Zealand guys had a great quote of this. If you have geothermal, do geothermal. Because it's going to be the cheapest and it's going to have the most benefit. So the advantages that we see are, if you don't have a geothermal resource, if I'm in Northern Ontario and I'm drilling 4 to 5 kilometers to get what you probably have here in 2, no, it's not going to fit. You don't have a geothermal resource, don't take it. But in the places you do, it should be your first choice.
Question.
Yeah?
You say the cycle takes between 7 to 8 years, kind of from the beginning to actually producing
yep.
the energy. How many years have you been at it so far?
On this location, 6. Let's go with 3.5. You could. And in many cases, it's the size of the project that dictates it too. So if I'm developing a small 5 to 10 megawatt project, I can usually move it faster through those programs. If I'm developing a 200 megawatt facility in Kenya, it's probably going to be a decade. So including all the drilling and permitting and everything else. So it's just a guideline. Helpful? We have, as I say, about a zillion hours of direct heat coming forward, but I just want to introduce the idea is that when we build power facilities, the turbine itself is only about 15% efficient. So for every 100 apples of energy, I'm actually only turning 15 of those gigajoules into actual power. So what do I do with the other 85 apples? Anything I want, because in many cases, my economic model is based on the power model. This is what's happened globally. In a place like, you know, let's say I have a project in Nicaragua, do I really need a heat resource? No, probably not. So it doesn't nearly have the value it does at minus 10, where I'm shipping food from California or I'm buying flowers from Chile. When we start to think about those in terms of how much value does the waste heat have, that's where the next, you know, 3 hours is going to be quite entertaining, because it really is about imagination in terms of what you can do with that. You know, there's, next thing you know, you're going to have a brewery that's open in Oregon, geothermally brewed. Yeah? So I got Mike in the back. I'm sure you guys all know Mike. But that's the type of thing is, well, what do I do with waste heat? We're going to see so many cool examples. And not, yeah, go ahead.
I'd like to know how many people that would employ just to this point where you're doing the drilling and getting it working.
Allison might know those numbers a little better. The short answer of this is that the power facility is a very sort of short-term job generator. It's about the drilling. It's about, you know, making sure access to power lines and interconnects. So those first few years, you have a lot of activity. I'm actually, as a developer, I want to develop that facility that has the lowest possible operation and maintenance. So I want the least number of people, least number of issues to make the electrons, because that's what's going to make the project successful in the long term. That nobody likes hearing that answer. The fact that the direct heat, though, is labor intensive. That is where you're starting to get greenhouse growing and all these other opportunities. Do you want to take a stab at that?
So in the direct use presentations, we'll talk about job creation. But for a power statistic, again, from the Department of Energy in the US, this isn't an association number. There's 17 times more jobs per megawatt of a geothermal power plant versus a natural gas plant. Or 11 times more jobs per megawatt for a geothermal plant versus a large hydro dam.
Is that because of the heat spinoff, or like?
That's just the power. Yeah.
So there's not an average then, say 100 people at one point, where you have them all here.
Have a go.
No, there are averages. Of course, in Canada, we haven't built any yet, so it's hard to give Canadian numbers, but the American numbers average between like 2.5 to 5 people per megawatt, depending on what technology you're using. Again, for power. The direct use numbers are much higher, and we're going to go over that in hopefully some inspiring detail at the next presentation.
I was just wondering whether there would be 1,000 people smack dab here for both work.
No.
Not during the build-out, but the direct use is intended to have as many jobs as you'd like to have.
The drilling side of it, rigs are about anywhere from 5 to 10. Double shifts, you're going to have, you know, 20 burly guys in town. And a couple very brave women. Yes?
Yes. 1995, Pacific Geopower. They drilled 3,000 meter drill hole in the Ninga Creek Mountains. I visited that time, it's about just less than 10 people working. This is huge. One is maybe $5 million drill hole, but almost 10 people and a couple local almost there. Because this drilling is a professional people. Okay. And after completion, okay, this is I come from Japan, it's called Nishiyama Power Plant. It's Japan's single biggest power plant, 65 megawatts. But I visited in 6 years ago, working just 4 people work. Big power plant, Japan's biggest single big power plant, 4 people. Maintain mechanicals, just 2 people. 2 people is a customer relation. If tourists come, see the power plant. This means 65 megawatts, just 4 people permanent. But locally, it's just one person, all from electric company, because a little bit mechanical thing is very. This is, I know them.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
How many people work in an oil well?
Within the production process?
No.
None. There's always going to be maintenance workers on in an area to do the work, so that you're going to have, you know, all of the local support for well maintenance and things like that. But, you know, those numbers are actually quite small. There's none currently working on a wellhead, I guess, is what I was getting at. There's lots of people working to keep those things going. Good clarification there. This is sort of a weird dream that I had after working on a oil and gas side of it for a long time, is I would love to turn every wellhead into a greenhouse. Is the amount of energy that we throw out is not thought of as part of their core business. We get that expression a lot. Industries are very, end up being in silos, as I do forestry, I do energy, and then if I'm in this industry, I go get help from that industry, but never the two shall meet. And so what we see is a lot of opportunity for a more holistic view about this, is that if I'm producing that heat on a farmer's land, what could I be doing with that? Could I be putting this guy back to work for the 5 months of the year that he's not? Does he want that heat resource? What could he do with it? And I think thinking about it a little bit more holistically would help our energy industry quite a bit. Just a couple quick examples. This is, you guys are going to talk about all this. Hydroponics and aquaponics and geodesic design, greenhouses for 4 seasons. One of the reasons we don't build beautiful greenhouses in a lot of these places is because of that natural gas cost. And you guys have those numbers coming up. Is that we could be growing food all year round. Anyone bought tomatoes lately and find out what those are worth? Call the $17 cauliflower. What was that number? $11 cauliflower. I got introduced to this idea of food security when I worked up in northern Canada. I remember going into one of the stores in the Northwest Territories, and there was a box of strawberries about this big. It looked a bit rough, to say the least, and it was $7. And I thought, that is crazy. You know, no, there's a good reason that we could afford to fix this. Da-da-da. Am I missing something, Allison? Do you have this active? Yeah, we'll find it during the break. Yeah. So I have 10 minutes. I want to talk about the geothermal opportunity here, specifically in Canoe Reach, We're going to go through these slides pretty quickly, but I'm more than available to talk at length about this, probably to nauseam, about the idea that why here? Why would I look at Canoe Reach specifically? Why develop this resource? The primary driver for this is both, it's 300 kilometers plus from your closest substation. You have a very, very long line. So non-geologically based at all, this is some of the worst power grid stability in the entire province. How does that sound? Is that accurate? I don't like saying it out loud. We're all friends here. It's good. We want to help fix that. So this comes back to power stability. It's one thing to sell, you know, earth heat and all that. We actually need to sell it into a market that needs it. And so what we looked at when we were looking at all the geothermal opportunities geologically, we also looked at it in terms of where is power needed, taking a distributed energy approach to this. That's probably, it's an end of line, difficult to serve region. To rebuild that line across the mountain is an extensive process. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. But we want to see this as an investment opportunity to be a distributed generation at the end of line, rather than always thinking that we need to upgrade these lines out to the communities. What if the community could put energy back and push power the other way? What would that look like for the grid system? And the community support. When we first approached into the towns and communities, Valemount in general has been extremely sweet. You guys have, you know, previous mayors, current mayors, Simp First Nation, you know, I'm sure Silvio's sick of showing me around town. I learned I have 22 years before I'm a local, is that right? I have had an unbelievably positive experience from what this community has offered back to us in terms of help. That is absolutely massive and can't be understated. How did we get into this space is probably a big one. We talk about team a lot. It's great to have an absolutely great resource, but the things that we do as a company, we're looking at sort of a new way of looking at exploration. Because we're limited by being first, we have to make sure that all of our stuff is top-notch. We have to be exploring faster and more efficient than everyone else. We have to be pushing the boundaries so that when we show people, hey, this is the work that we do, it's above board. And I think, you know, you can look at the resume side of the equation about how we do 3D modeling and exploration mapping and things like that. But one of the things that really got us started on the right path is to look at things not just from a geologic base, but also looking at the economic model associated. Is geothermal viable? In which areas? And can we make it work? We have two other projects moving forward. The one at Canoe Reach has been since 2010. We have another project with Kitsilis First Nations support up near Terrace. That's actually host to Canada's hottest hot spring, which is a good place to start. And then we've been working on a project in Fort Liard for quite a long time now. And this one's in a very, very small project, less than a megawatt, but it's actually designed to offset diesel. So if anyone knows anything about producing energy from a diesel generator, it's about anywhere from 5 to 10 times what you're playing locally. So that power cost, to offset it with something renewable, is a great economic opportunity. This is what we want to build. We want to build something that's renewable, it's clean, it has the support of the community, but also as a destination. We want to build not just a power plant, but a showcase opportunity so that people can come and say, hey, how did they do that? How did it go? Can I visit the facility? The idea of going to visit a power facility, how many of you guys have gone, yay, we're going to go see the natural gas plant? Nobody? Not even a coal facility? No. Okay, tough crowd. But how many of you visited a wind farm? Okay. Was that thoroughly enjoyable or kind of lame?
Pretty breezy.
I think it's pretty cool. I took my kids to stop at the one in Pincher Creek a while ago, and it was an opportunity to educate as well, just to show them this is how you can make energy. And you don't have to visit. It's not like there's a door, right? You can just stop and go, look, kids, a turbine. That's actually one of the major advantages of the wind and solar guys is that you can visually see the energy being produced. And from a marketing perspective, that's gold. That's an amazing opportunity to get community on board. And for us, you know, do you want to look at a wellhead? Probably not. But would it be really neat to show that this is how much power is online if you walked into a facility that looks like that? Looks like a library. Significant line upgrades. This little tiny map on the bottom here, hopefully everyone can see that. That's actually a redo of the 1992 map, and then some of the Kangea's work as well, looking at favorability, looking at where are the best places to start looking in the province. So geothermal opportunity, it's not necessarily a treasure map, but it's a good place to start looking. So, you know, the top northwest corner is actually Xiza National or Xiza Provincial Park. We see opportunities like that where you have octavolcanoes. That one's kind of a no-brainer. On the bottom right-hand, southwest corner is Meager Creek, Pemberton, Pebble Creek. This is what Mike was talking about. Incredibly hot resource, active volcanism. These are places that we should look, as geologists, we look right away and go, why are we not developing that? Now, there may be some technical economic opportunities that you have to overcome, or technical issues that you have to overcome for some of these spots. But as you see right on this map, that line that draws basically from the Radium Fairmont area up through all the way north is actually part of that Rocky Mountain Trench that I was talking about. That giant fracture system extends literally from just about the US border all the way into the northern Canada. Anyone pull out a globe, you can actually visually see how it works. To me as a geologist, that's pretty cool. Not gonna lie. This is your power line. How many people have seen this map that live in the area? Two. This, when you lose power, anywhere along that line goes out, you're gonna have problems. 304, 302 kilometers, I think we measured it one day. That's a very, very crucial slide, because to upgrade that line, you can ask BC Hydro what that's gonna cost, because they won't tell me. The other opportunities are, the Robson Valley is moving forward. You know, the guys at the Valemount Glacial Destination have done a phenomenal job of, you know, trying to engage the community, talking about this. But this is another chunk of energy that's gonna be needed in this area. The other aspect of it is the Kinder Morgan pipeline, if it moves forward, will also need more power online. These are opportunities rather than problems. So for us, we look at this and say, rather than try and send more power up that line, let's put the power where it's needed right at the end of the line. So these are your solutions. Diesel. You actually can produce power with diesel without messing up the Clean Energy Act, because what you have to do is say, hey, I want your clean energy, and then they say, no, we can't get it to you because we don't have enough room on the line, at which point you can default back to the diesel generation. So this is a legitimate possibility. It's only about, in this case, anywhere from about 4 to 10 times the current power supply. So if you want to pay, you know, it would be 4 to 5 times more for power, then your diesel option is just fine. The natural gas act, you guys don't have natural gas in the area, so that one's up there, but it would, the cost to bring in natural gas to the area is also gonna compromise some of the Clean Energy Act stuff. So we like this last one. Anyone heard about this? Yeah, okay, good. The first one, though, we talked about is that, you know, what does it cost to upgrade a line that's 300 kilometers long through a mountain range? As a geeky geologist, we have taken a number of sort of chemical analysis. Biogeochemical is actually where we're looking at the unique chemistry of individual trees in the area, and they tell us a lot about the subsurface chemistry, allowing us to see where the fault systems and unique fluid flow is. That's about as geeky as I get. And we've had some pretty phenomenal results doing a number of other non-invasive techniques, including soil degassing, seismic analysis, looking at structural movement over time. And in this recent summer, we actually finished with the University of Alberta a magnetotelluric survey. Nobody has any idea what that is, so that's just fine. What we're trying to do is determine the best places along this Rocky Mountain fault that is the most obvious fluid flow. So I'm looking for heat and permeability using a number of geotechnical techniques. We have borrowed, begged, stole from a multitude of other industries in terms of some of these strategies. So in Italy, the CO2 analysis was able to accurately tell them where to drill even before they started their drilling program. So there's examples like that globally that we borrow and use that technology in our own application here. I've been there. What's that place called? That's where we do all our meetings, the Three Ranges, a pub. This goes back to the conversation we had earlier, is that, you know, do we have community support? I'd like to think we do. You know, we've worked really hard to try and keep the community up to par about the activities that we're doing. This is a huge aspect for any project development is, do you have the support of the very people who are going to live with that turbine every day? Right? Is that going to be an eyesore? Is it going to be supportive? I actually had Fred Fortier at a conference about 3 years ago, and he came out, and they asked him about geothermal, and he went on an awesome, about a 10-minute rant. And then they asked me about, you know, do I have anything else to add? And I was like, you know, if that's the approach that they're happy with, then, you know, why would I add anything? And I think for me, that's really exciting, is that we've helped to educate the community. So now, you know, I catch Silvio talking to people about the geothermal opportunity. So that's a good sign for us in general. What's next? This is us walking across the lake, which is always a bit weird to people when we show them, but we realize that this reservoir opportunity, we've been out here every time it's dry, and we're taking a number of samples and learning about the resource. Geochemical, soil, geophysical mapping, a ton of 3D modeling, favorability. We really need to be moving forward with the last bit of our geophysical program and our drilling program. And that's going to start, you know, we hope it'll be starting in 2016. Once we move forward with that last bit of slim hole and core hole drilling, then we can verify our subsurface resources there, and then we move forward with the power production, power purchase agreements, and final production drilling. 3 years? That was your question earlier? End of the day, what are we trying to do? We're trying to build a 15 megawatt facility, again, about 15,000 homes. That would put us under the standard offer program through the BC Hydro EPA, or electrical purchase agreements. And then really work to build out that heat resource opportunity as well. Is start to build those necessary corporate connections that allow us to be able to sell that heat out to the people who need it and want it, whether that's greenhouses or agriculture or otherwise. Get this question a lot, so we're going to put it up here. This is about an $80 million project, all in, power purchase and everything. Power facility and everything. At the end of the day, we actually have a decent return. This 11 to 13% return that you have here, which we leave it to the end because everybody asks, and if I show them this slide first, they stop listening to all the other presentation. Who would be happy with an 11% return? No? Yeah. This is pretty respectable. When it's $120 a barrel, this wasn't enough. I'm going to be really honest about this. This didn't cut it. And now we're seeing that there's a lot more people that are phoning me back for a nice change. The advantage that we have with these programs is we actually, this number is power alone. We're starting to rebuild this model using what we can sell for heat, also tax credits, and a number of other sort of attributes associated with ancillary services, which is the stability to the grid. So if we can actually sell not only the electrons, but the ability to stabilize the grid, that has another revenue stream as well. So when we do these calculations, we kept them as simple as possible, unlevered returns for all the bankers. At the end of the day, an $80 million project in the energy sector is actually quite small, to the point that it's almost insignificant to people who build 100 megawatt facilities. So we're in this sort of weird financial gray area of you're too big for friends and family, but you're too small for, you know, the CPPs of the world, investment profile. What we're seeing is there's more and more interest in some of these smaller distributed projects if we can pool them all together. Little economics 101. From an investment perspective, you know, this is its long-term investment profile. And I get that, and I actually I'm an advocate that we should be looking at energy on a 30-year cycle, because this is the energy and the legacy that we're going to leave for our kids. So I have a 7- and a 9-year-old. On a personal level, I want to be able to say I helped build that for you. I didn't give you a geologic mess or an environmental disaster at the end of my sort of career. So that, you know, on a personal level, that's sort of what drives some of this, but I think it's not just about, you know, this is a good idea and it's warm and fuzzy. We want people to understand that this is economically viable. And so when we talk about geothermal for the next generation, no, we need to start this now. We need to be working on this literally 10 years ago if we were doing it right. So that's a big driver, I think, for me in general. You guys got this. I'm going to interview all of you later, and I'm going to do what we do, a 30-second elevator pitch. And I'm going to say, hey, explain geothermal to me. And you're going to go, I got this. It's clean, it's renewable, it's base load. It's capital intensive, but it has a long-term solid return with no fuel cost. Think everyone's got that? There's a couple people that are like, no chance. I'm not taking the elevator with Craig. I think at the end of the day, we just want people to understand the basics. Ask me lots of questions after, that's not a problem, but we want you guys to understand what this could mean and why I spend so much of my time talking about it and trying to work these projects forward. I left it as a question mark because that's how the CNN does it. They can say whatever they want if they leave it with a question mark. So I'll ask you guys, you know, is this something that we see for the next generation? Is this an energy resource you can get behind? Questions? Was that a question? How far between production and injection? That's kind of what you're getting at? Oh, between projects. Okay, so one of the issues that we see is, Allison asked a question about communication and reservoirs. In the oil and gas industry, if you own a certain section of reservoir, this is a good question actually. If you own a section of reservoir that you have the geothermal permit, you saw that on there, or an oil and gas permit to develop that resource. What they don't want is somebody on one edge of your permit and the other one, basically too many straws in the milkshake. So what we can do is we can actually drain the resource for the next guy on his property. So we've acquired the geothermal permit in this area that allows us access under the geothermal code to produce water greater than 80 C for any production value. So whether it's power or heat or that accordingly. That regulatory environment gives us sort of first dibs, which reduces the risk for our entire project. So if anyone could just come in after or before us and tap into that resource, it would put our whole project at risk. So BC Energy and Mines recognizes that, and that's part of the whole mining process as well, is I call dibs is sort of how it works. What that also allows us to do is to understand how to manage a reservoir as a whole. So if we have, you know, 1,000 other straws that come in, you can't manage your reservoir if somebody else is pulling on that reservoir at the same time as you are. And so what happens is a good example of this in Northern California. There was a situation where they put all the permits way too close together. And what happened is the first companies went, oh my God, if I don't draw as much heat as I can, my neighbor's going to. So what do you think the neighbor did? He did the same thing, and the neighbor beside him. So what happened is you had this incredible heat resource, and everyone went as fast as they possibly could, cooled down the whole reservoir. So not just one guy go broke, they all go broke. So everyone goes, oh, geothermal doesn't work. So a bunch of them went broke, they closed in all the wells. People came back 10 years later, and it was as hot, if not hotter in some cases, than it was. So I've worked in oil and gas, that doesn't happen, right? You don't have the opportunity to go back in 10 years and go, oh, we kind of screwed up the reservoir the first time, but it's reheated, so let's make sure we do a better job of managing this. So I think one of the big issues in this area is being the sole permit owner for, you know, 100 miles in each direction allows us to be able to manage that reservoir carefully so that we can get a long-term sustainability out of that system. And that's a big one for me as well. Is that helpful?
How big is a reservoir?
That's the reason. That's why we're not sure. So lots of global projects will start at 30 or 50 or 100 megawatts. What we actually like about the 15 megawatt design is that we are very confident that there's more than 15 megawatts of thermal energy at, you know, 2 to 3 kilometers. What that allows us to do is to develop it, watch it, model it, understand it, and then decide if we want to expand that resource. So how far does that reservoir go? Until people are drilling it and literally understanding how that water is moving around in now and in 2, 3, 5 years, that's going to allow us to know how big the reservoir truly is. Short answer, I don't know yet.
So you've talked a lot about water being the transfer, but I'm presuming some places in the province there must be dry ones as well, where the heat is close to the surface, but there's no water.
Yep.
Is that correct?
Yeah. There actually are places that I don't want to go to those places for the first, because I need that water as that transfer medium. But there are lots of dry heat applications. Southeast of Kamloops, there's a number of sort of deep granitic pluton environments where you have a giant heat resource, but you have no fracture system and therefore no water. Does that kind of answer your question? Yeah. So heat's great, but if I can't get the heat to surface, it's stuck.
Now, would this plant operate on a standalone basis as well?
A standalone business?
Yeah.
In terms of...
A few years ago, there was a forest fire and we lost our power here for 6 weeks. So would that plant be able to power locally?
Oh, yeah. It's the term in the... electrical industry is islanding. So what we can actually do is, because we're a baseload capacity, we can actually build the facility to be able to not only start on its own, with even just a simple generator to get the process started, get the pumps running. So if the whole thing shut down and you had to kick the thing back in, start it, we can do what's called black starting. So that means you start from a cold building, you get the pumps started, and then the geothermal opportunity, you get a couple megawatts online, and then you can get the whole thing going. If that line was to cut, let's say, you know, somewhere around Clearwater or whatever, you could actually have enough energy from that facility to power the Robson Valley.
But it would have proper 6 years.
We could, you can do the design incorporated in that. So when you actually go and create that agreement with BC Hydro, that would be part of your discussion. Do you want this capability or do you not want this capability, right? And then you build that into the design. I'm really hoping they would want that capability. But. Does that help?
Yeah. I'm just thinking that the people that live here should have quite a bit to say about it.
Absolutely.
PC Hydro wants that.
That is a very, very good point, and I would love to have the community reiterate that when we have those discussions with BC Hydro. Is that a nice way to put it? I can see Corey laughing in the background.
I'm just wondering, your exploration program, how much of that data is proprietary and how much of that is public? The university data, is that also public available? And what do you post with, like, Department or the Ministry of Energy and Mines that other users can start deriving off?
Joe, you can't see any of it. That's the short answer. Not only is our data proprietary in terms of how we gather it, but we do have to provide all of our exploration data, including all the data files and data sets, to the BC Energy and Mines every year. We've continued to do that and keeping our lease in good standing is the correct thing. The advantage that we have for our exploration and intellectual property associated with exploration is that this stays private until such time as we renege on our lease. So if we actually drop the permit, I think it's, assuming you can clarify, it's either a year or 5 years before that data becomes public. I'm a huge advocate that if I walked from this project, that somebody else could take what we learned and move forward with it. While I'm developing it, no. So I find that that's a fairly good balance, and it's helped for a lot of the mining exploration guys as well.
If we get public health, university research and all that, is that confidentiality agreement also proprietary, or would that data be available?
I don't know. I'll have to talk about it. I'm more generous than I should be with our data, according to my business partners. The advantage that we have is that we are doing stuff that's on the cutting edge, so we do have to kind of find that balance between what's proprietary and what can be public. Do you really want geotechnical data on biogeochemistry? You might, actually. So that's a good question, though.
Can I ask it a different way?
Sure.
We would really like the government and the academic institutions to do research. So I don't know if it's well known, but the Geological Survey of Canada had their funding cut several times over the past 40 years, and it's not been reinstated for probably at least the past kind of six, seven years. So we're one of the only countries in the world who doesn't support the whole industry segment the way oil or coal or wind or solar is supported.
From a research perspective, for sure, yeah.
We'd love to have all kinds of things made public, because we'd use it too. But that's kind of out of one developer's hands. That's more of a political question about what the province and the federal government is willing to do for the industry.
That said, great to thanks to BC Geoscience, who's actually supporting events like this. So this is another side of it, is we are slowly seeing more and more interest in this sector, which then supports the research side, which then supports collaboration. We've worked with both the USC and the U of A. We have a UBC intern, and the Simon Fraser University is hoping to partner with us on some of the direct heat. And all that data becomes public as when it's published. So collaborating with research is definitely going to help this industry in the long term.
I just wondered whereabouts you plan to go. Is this?
It was on the east side of the lake, mile 10 to 20, or kilometer 10 to 20. So for us, we're in the process of finalizing some of that where exactly is the best place to go. We've had this discussion too, which is noteworthy. The hot springs on the west side of the lake, from a construction and viability for economic development, we didn't want to go down a road that was avalanched every year. So there was a number of opportunities for us to start looking at places that were more accessible for a power facility. Seems pretty reasonable, eh?
Any idea how many wells or pairs of wells you're going to need to get your 15 megawatts?
Seven. No, not well pairs, seven wells in total. Longer story. So seven wells that start out about this big and move a great deal of water at a very high temperature. That can't be the last question. All right. Oh, one at the back. That's a good question. One of the processes that we want to take part in with backward and directional drilling is actually to minimize our well pad. It actually increases the efficiency of the plant itself because I don't have to move water as far. And so we centralize that well plan as tight as we possibly can and then use the subsurface as your exposure. So you drill wells that kind of look like that. That allows us to increase how close those well heads are to each other and to the plant itself. A couple of football fields. Okay. Yeah, probably four. All in.
American or Canadian side?
I play soccer, so I was like, yeah, that one's standard. I think 4:15, right? I did them on time.
So do you return the water back to the same rough location that you extracted it from?
Yes, absolutely. The reservoir, not only from a heat perspective, but from a pressure perspective, I want to make sure that I design that system so that the water has, from the injection, enough time in the reservoir to get to the production well and keep its heat. So if I drag all the water out of that system, one, I have to dispose of it. What do I do with that? That's a high impact environment for footprint. And then the other aspect of it is I actually need that water to bring my heat to surface. So the injection program, the subsurface reservoir or geophysics associated with that is actually quite complicated. And one of the reasons that we need to do as much science as we do during the drilling process.
You've got a well going down, a well coming up. How do you get seven?
I bank on a screw up. The short answer is we've actually designed this system to be as conservative as possible based on international experience in drilling.
So backup well.
Yeah. And in many cases, we may actually be able to inject more on the in the injection wells than we can on the production wells. So there's quite a bit of sort of mathematics associated with how much water I'm moving and then where into the reservoir and volumes. Yeah, absolutely. I knew somebody was going to ask me because seven's like, how seven? Whole project, $80 million. Power facility is approximately 45% of that.
And how much does...
How much are you going to give me?
Digging each well, how much would it cost? Just
some of that is proprietary.
Okay.
If I can bug you offline.
Okay. Do you see hydro running the wires if you're going to top thing? The wires only go to top 12.
Yes. No. Yeah, yes, there we have to make sure that we get down all the way right to the distribution line. And no, the discussion when you negotiate your power purchase agreement comes into your transmission interconnection costs. So we would actually have to debate who gets to cover that difference. In many cases, it's the independent power producer who pays that delivery. But that's, I think the expression is open to the negotiation, which should be so much fun. I'm good, 4:15.
Let's get out of here.